Hi everyone, this is Dawn. Welcome to my channel and thank you very much for watching the videos and for liking and subscribing. I'm here today with a pretty important message and there is going to be noise in the background and I apologize for that, but I'm unable to get out because they're doing some work at the house and I'm blocked in. So, but when I asked, I was told it was more important to record the video than to wait. So I apologize for any noise, but this video is entitled Webs of Deceit, Disillusionment, and Standing Strong in the Awe of God. Let me give you a little bit of background. So last week I had a really blissful week, and when I recorded the video I did for Easter, essentially, I really thought that would be my last for the next couple of weeks due to, you know, my choice to center in on some things in my life, but I was told otherwise on Sunday night after, you know, just a really week of calm. I think this is no accident that this noise is in the background. So after a week of calm and, you know, really zen-like experience on Sunday night, I did not sleep at all. So at first I thought that was only, you know, just the early full moon energies coming in, but it quickly became apparent it was something else. And I didn't sleep the entire night. At 5:55 in the morning, I got up and I immediately was, you know, kind of told to turn on the video camera and record a video, which I did. I'm not sharing that video right now because it was 2.5 hours long. And so I'm going to maybe possibly edit and share bits of it in the coming weeks. I'll see how that feels. But essentially, I was reminded of a series of dreams I had beginning in 1999. And there were three waves of dreams and experiences and, you know, kind of, I suppose you could call them visions, prophetic visions. And so I may share some of those down the road. But today's video is going to, it's very important, and it's going to include five components. The first is a direct message from Jesus specifically to those of us who are called here now for this time, for what is unfolding right now in our world. And the second part of this video is sort of a synthesis of what it was that I was shown that has unfolded through thousands of years. Some of that relates to some of the dreams and some of it is, you know, more of my own observations. But, it, you know, I've been asked to share that with you. Many of us are talking about this right now. We all see it. That's why you probably noticed, you know, more and more of those who are, you know, called out to be love leaders in this time are speaking to this. And there is sort of an urgency with the messages of late. That's no accident. So the third thing in this video will be wisdom from a particular treasure text that was given to me by the angels on Sunday night. It is, interestingly, again, from the book of Isaiah. So I don't know if there maybe is something there for us to look at that book. I'm going to be possibly revisiting that myself, but I'll share that passage at the end of the video so that those of you who aren't interested can, you know, listen to the message and then move on. The fourth thing I'll share is quick guidance from a card I will draw from the Mary Queen of the Angels deck to support us and how we can best move forward. And then last of all, I will link to several poems which relate to some of the dreams that I was reminded of and shown. And I do see so much, so clearly how things are unfolding right now. So again, like after this week of, like, truly for me, it was beautiful. I do, the first week of April, as I mentioned in the other video, is the week when I personally draw my attention back to Holy Week, if you will, and the events that happened 2,000 years ago around the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus, the one called the Christ. I'm going to keep talking, so I hope that you can, you know, you can hear me through this. So I had this week of calm and beauty and zen and grace, and yet beginning Sunday night, Saturday night, and into Sunday a little bit, and then today's Monday, I believe it's the 10th, yeah, 10th of April. And I'm feeling a little more, you know, shaky and uncertain, but I'm aware that that shakiness and uncertainty is around, you know, just sort of our entire reality, and there's a rumbling on the horizon, as if the, like, the very foundations of our world are being or will be shaken, and as if everything is turned on its head and will be seen kind of from the inside out. And things are being exposed for what they are. We all see that, and we all know that. And I think that it's going to continue, and I believe that the waves are going to actually heighten, and we will see more dramatic revelations, exposures, and it can be sickening and or cause an immediate wanting to react and just push it away, deny it, or otherwise say that's not the world I'm living in, and go on. And so I'm going to talk to that in this video. Some of what, you know, will be revealed, I believe, will be a huge shock to the system, if you will, and not just the system, as in the system of, you know, government and the top echelon, but our whole way of living, of being, of who we are, of seeing the world, who we see ourselves to be. And the issues of freedom and sovereignty will be primary. So, you know, there's this feeling that everything's going to be turned on its head, sort of. And I also believe, I don't like saying this, I've got to admit, I don't like saying this at all, because I really have been one who's been very hopeful that collectively we will choose to avert the lesser path. And in some ways, I believe we are doing that, and we can individually do that. And that's our calling, right, is to be that love. But some of what it will be revealed, the insidiousness and the ugliness of it will, you know, kind of show us the worst of humanity. It'll be plain to see. And I believe that we need to be prepared. We must be prepared. And this is, I'm moving in now to what Jesus directly spoke to me, so I'm sharing it with you. So we must be prepared to correct. I'm going to read this, by the way. We must be prepared to correct our own participation at whatever level in webs of deceit and rippling circles of the true harm brought to humanity. This means we must be diligent more than ever before in doing the work of our souls, in guarding the treasures of our hearts. We must be prepared to stand firm. This is number two. That was number one. Number two, we must be prepared to stand firm in the whole of who we are, to return to that which is good and holy, and to cultivate from our core the essential truth and beauty of who we are individually and collectively. So this must be done at the same time, is what he was showing me and telling me, is that we can't do one or the other. We must remain committed to both. To stand firm in the whole of who we are individually, as independent souls, independent is probably not the best word, but you get the idea, you know, in our own sphere of influence, and collectively, we must do both. The third thing he said is we must be prepared to open our arms to those who will be most shaken from these revelations. Sorry. From the very epicenter of what unfolds, you must come together in a circle, hearts wide open in complete faith and trust, arms outstretched in complete welcome of all who have been affected, which is every soul, no matter how damaged we may see them as, or no matter how much damage we may see in front of us. In other words, what he was speaking to me about is that, for me personally, I think, but also I think this applies to many of us, is that it will be so ugly, and to many of us who are sensitive, it will be so jarring, and, you know, it maybe won't be so much of a surprise to some of us, but it will be so distasteful that all we want to do is just hide in our little cocoons and avoid the disruption. And we can't afford to do that, because this is why we are here. This is who we are. Let me repeat what he said. From the very epicenter of what unfolds, you must come together in a circle, hearts wide open in complete faith and trust, arms outstretched in complete welcome of all who have been affected, which is every soul, no matter how damaged they may appear. So I think there's a lot there to there's a lot there. When I that third one in particular impacted me. So I will put those three things at the very least in the description below, so you can refer to those. So I'm gonna move into the synthesis a little bit. And again, I may share some of the dreams that, you know, I was reminded of, because they are, I see now, I didn't see at the time when I had them. It just looked like death, the destruction of the world, kind of a, like a World War III, you know, and also a, it was very dark and dire and desperate times, you know, similar to what the Book of Revelation, the language that's used there. But I see it in a different way now. So I'm going to move into kind of my synthesis. So I hope you stay with me for this, because I think that there are threads of this that are drawn directly from things that were, you know, revealed to me, and then, again, my own interpretation. So as many of you who have watched my videos before know, I believe at our core we are all light and life and love. And we've only separated ourselves from that because we believe or have been told that we are not worthy of being one with God. I'm going to put my glasses on so I can look at my notes. So we believe that we've separated ourselves from this, the fact that we are light and life and love, even if we profess it over and over and over again. The truth is, there's still within each of us that it's really, we really have to be diligent about those very subtle separations that get dropped in. And we've separated that because we believe, or we've been told, that we're not worthy of being one with God, or one with one another, or even that we are whole and complete as we are, that we're, you know, that we weren't created as some lowly, sinful, you know, people in need of saving, and from a source outside of ourselves. The sad reality is that even those of us, you know, who know and have been shown that we, that, you know, and believe that we are light and we are life and we are love, we lose the connection with that. I am, I'm one who's struggled with that all of my life, losing that connection. I know it, and I know it even in my heart, and yet life makes it very difficult. So, you know, just let's think about the entire, all of creation, the world here, and all people. So what's happened is, over many generations, we've come to believe in a world where people must be checked or corralled or coerced into right behavior. You know, I'm talking society itself has, you know, the majority of people have come to believe that, you know, of course you have to, you know, have rules and law. The trouble with the creation of that kind of world is that it only leads to repression, to restriction, to constriction, to a perpetuation of the belief within the individual person who has, will inevitably act out what has been repressed within that person. And then they begin to believe that, that person begins to believe that he or she is defective, weak, perverted, broken, not to be trusted, or just simply beyond the hope, you know, all hope of redemption. And so there, it's, you see the cycle there, right? Like they, and it creates, what is created is an atmosphere of fear in the collective. And so even when we see that, it becomes very subtle, for, you know, and it's at various levels. Now, some people are immediately sucked into that and, you know, have so much fear that they begin to live their lives, around some perceived solution to experiencing that fear of who they are at their core. And so you can see how quickly, in you know, varying levels of degree, but how quickly that those separations begin to, you know, be dropped within us without our even awareness of that. So it is the fear, and specifically the fears of being cast out or rejected or abandoned, that lead us to a choice, one by one, whereby, you know, and I'm reading here from something I wrote, sorry about the language, but I'm just going to read it. I think that'll be easier. It is fear, and specifically the fear of being cast out, rejected, and abandoned, that leads to a choice one by one, whereby we forfeit personal power and authority to some perceived leader, organization, or system of belief that we think will help us and guide us and keep us from harm. So the illusion of greater law and order, or a society that is safe and secure, kind of casts a spell of, you know, perceived harmony and balance. So we think, we see, oh, okay, so this is good. Yeah, that's being taken care of. That's being taken care of. Okay. And so what happens is we're forfeiting our own personal responsibility because we believe that we've set up all of these systems to take care of things like that. And so we also begin to believe that we are safe, and that we, and or some of us, that we have been saved. And it's a subtle thing that happens. We don't even recognize it at first, that this is the forfeiture of our personal accountability in favor of following the rules of one society or group or another. So, and when I use the word society and group and organization in this video, I mean, it happens at all different levels. It can happen in a very small group of individuals who come together around a certain intention or belief. And it can happen, you know, in society at large and in governments and in religion and some of the larger systems and structures that we've created. So what happens is, okay, so when our individual intuition kind of nudges us that, wait, something is off, what happens is that because we have gone down this path so far, that we cling to that world that we've come to know, because to question certain foundational systems and structures would leave us, we fear, you know, sort of exposed and vulnerable, and our whole world would change and we would lose people. And then you get into all of the, you know, where our mind takes us with those things. And so, you know, I'm talking by the way, when I say we, I'm talking just generally here about, you know, what the patterns at play. So our intuition, maybe it nudges us, something is off, and yet we start clinging to things and we cite all of the obvious reasons why we've made the choices we've made, which essentially were to relinquish our personal responsibility. And these excuses, these reasons, these rationalizations are often inside of our head. They're internal, but sometimes they do get externalized as well. And so over time, you know, we, humanity, falls into a deeper sleep and farther from the true source and wellspring of our life. And we forget what life really is. And so there's this underlying feeling of panic, and it becomes an energy with a life all its own. And it creates this atmosphere of an atmosphere that is rife with distrust. And that distrust can be distrust in yourself, distrust in the other, distrust in life itself. And so we become, you know, desperate to escape this kind of existence where we know something is off, you know, and there's like this panic, or this energy begins to have a life of its own. And in that state, because we feel that, like, oh, something is off and we've got to fix this, we become more vulnerable to manipulation and control. And so those who are already, and I'm talking over time too here, so like those back 2,000 years that it also happens, it's a continuing pattern. And so those who are already in, you know, some position of power or authority, usually, actually, because their souls feel, the people in power also feel, their souls feel that dissonance between who they are projecting themselves to be and who they truly are. And then so they face greater and greater temptation to use that fear, that energy of fear, and the frenzy to their advantage. And then again, they rationalize, you know, they justify the means to an end, and they use that fear, and they begin to draw upon it to, and they're essentially doing it to push away their own inner feeling of insecurity, that is what still exists within them, because they realize, wait, this isn't working. There's this moment of realization, but most people at that point push it away, and they go deeper, sadly, into
illusion and delusion. And so meanwhile, there's this undercurrent of distrust. It's now running rampant, you know, in the background. And it's overpowering to many sensitive souls. It's just literally, it's like we don't feel good about our lives, this world, who we are. And it's just everywhere. And so when we try to compensate, right? But at the same time, that undercurrent of distrust that's everywhere, it's reflected back to us, it's within us, it's around us, it's become something that is fed off of, it's fed back to us through various media outlets and other groups and systems. And we most people begin to feel like an internal shame about who they are. And it drives some people to surrender more and more of themselves to an external locus of control. In other words, they look for the solution out there, and they find one that feels like a good fit. Maybe it's because, maybe it's in religion or in national identity or in service to a cause. And they see that, okay, this is good. It makes them feel better, and perhaps it is truly aligned. The actual beliefs being espoused perhaps are in alignment with what they, with their souls knowing. But they begin to become blind to the methods that are being used, and so they surrender to this external authority, if you will, or control, or group, or system. And this fuels the potential abuse that eventually arises within religion, government, any group that exerts power in any particular realm of society. And it's all feeding on this energy of distrust, and it's using the energy sometimes in a very subconscious way, because we're not completely away. Excuse me for a sec. Drop something. We're not fully attuned, and we get distracted, and we're not really seeing what's happening here, and we have a hard time believing that, the energy itself can be something that because we're so practical, and so many of the people in power and positions of power and authority have gained that position through the use of their logic and through mind, and so what has happened is that intuition gets, it's definitely a distant second in terms of what is used, what is drawn upon. And so because of that, there is this obvious, energy that's there, and this, you call it what you want, you call it evil, you can call it distraction, you could call it whatever, but it's there, and it's used to gain ground, sort of. And again, some of the people in these positions of power and authority, especially in the beginning, it's not that they are trying to, many of them are not trying to be despots or trying to take anything from anyone else. They are simply trying to further build their house that creates an illusion of safety for themselves. It's really that simple. So those who become entangled, though, with or even tied to the structure of these kinds of systems where that are built up as typically for perceived safety and security, they are often the individuals, and that's all of us at one time or another in our lives, and to some one degree or another, that's all of us. And what happens is you become so far removed from, or again, it's a distant second, that awareness of your wholeness and your true heart and the fullness of who we are and the fullness of life. We become so far removed from that that we become blind. We no longer see the web in which we are caught or operating. Some of us, the analogy is often used of the hamster on the wheel. I often like to think of a spider in a web. The web is the world to the spider, the web is the world. And until that storm comes in, what's that old song?
Itsy Bitsy Spider, you know? And there's a great, I love one of the Seeds for Life in my 90 Days to Life, which is, I'll try to put a link below about that, which is about this very thing, and that what many of us make the mistake when the web is washed away, we build in the same place thinking that is, because we have become so accustomed to the illusion that we ourselves created or co-created in life, that we simply do it again and again and again and again. And this is the breakpoint that we're at in our world. We can't do it the same way anymore. We simply cannot continue to do this. So those people who are caught up in it, like, they become blind to the fact that they are caught in anything. And so some of us believe we are doing good, and we become completely blinded to the systemic evil and the damage done to those who once were in that web, who become perceived as a threat and therefore excised from a particular system or a web. And this happens again and again and again in somewhat, I believe we're about to see, in somewhat dramatic fashion. And in things are hidden and swept under the rug and concealed. And it will be shocking. But all of us can relate to that to some degree or another, whether we've experienced been the one who has been, you know, perceived in such a way and conveniently cut out, or whether we have watched it happen, or whether we have, and it's probably all three, or whether we have been the, you know, at the core of those making those decisions. We've been among those who betrayed our own. So those caught up in these various webs of deceit, which are interconnected, they hardly think about the collective anymore, the larger collective. They hardly think about humanity, because the world is their world is the world. And do you see how this works? And so they many of us, and I'm saying they, but it's we. So we live in a self-created reality that literally feels so safe from this other world that we see as dark, and then we become blind to the dark deeds that sustain the illusion of our own safety, and so we believe that we have pure motives and we are doing good works. And so many of these organizations, systems, structures are indeed in name and in original. And originally there is a true stream. There is a true stream in nearly everything. Now there are certainly those who are nefarious and you know, and dark, you know, in terms of their motives, and who set out from the beginning to create chaos and wreak havoc. But by and large, this has happened over time, and it's a very subtle unfolding. So people caught up, they assume when their intuition says, oh, something's off here, and they see something happening within the system organization, they think, well, surely that can't be, or there must be a good reason, right? That's what we tell ourselves. There must be a good reason. And we simply again, forfeit our personal responsibility. We give our power over, and we go with the system, and we don't make waves. Those who do make waves are often experience firsthand the that same, you know, it's the same thing, right? The perpetrator and the victim and the bystander, and it's like on and on and on. So in recent times, right now in our world, on various strands of these interconnected webs of deceit that we, okay, so in various of the webs and in various strands, like, and we, all of us are connected in some way to some of what I'm talking about. We, individuals at various places within that, those systems, whatever system or organization or group, have been given glimpses. And there's always a choice. There are choice points along the way, and there are opportunities for us to see truth. And some have seen, yet the degree of darkness and the depth of deception that we saw so frightened us or so frightened those who saw that they retreated, right? People retreat from that truth because they're terrified it will unravel all they've ever known and all they've ever worked for and all the good they thought they were doing and all the ways they believed the little lies were doing no harm. Right? They wrote it off and they become aware of that on some level. And so that terrifies people. I've been here. And so some people, because they, of the degree of culpability that they realize how that they've been deceived and or actually been a part of the larger deception, they feel trapped. Right? They feel too far gone. They feel compromised, and perhaps they have been compromised in some very real way. And they're sickened by themselves, or they're unable for some reason to extract themselves for fear of repercussions for, you know, that they don't think they can withstand, or perhaps for fear of being able to survive it because they would lose everything, you know, and often for us in modern society, that boils down to love and money and to relationships that matter to us, to people that we feel couldn't accept us if they knew the truth and or our belongings or what we've built, the kingdoms we have built with financial abundance or other sorts of material possessions. And it's a real challenge to, when you're in it, it's a real challenge to get out of it. And all of us know this in some aspect, in some way. So some people, when they are caught up, when they have come to this point, this realization on some level, however strong that is, they seek to work harder and harder to compensate. Like, and to do that, they will be turned to good works, to philanthropy, to standing for causes that they believe will somehow repair some of the damage done, right? Like maybe they see this the webs of deceit and what, and how it's really having an impact or an effect on a particular, say, disenfranchised group of people and, or could be anything or individuals. And so they will fool themselves. They literally will, they won't directly lie to themselves, but they will say, okay, they will be drawn to a particular cause, or to support a particular viewpoint, or to fight for the rights of a particular group. And what they don't see is that internally, nothing has changed. Because they still believe themselves to be in need of the very system or structure that perpetuates these waves of continued damage and destruction. And it leads to the ruination of souls. And it leads to death. And it is a real thing. And yet they are still, even when they seek to withdraw somehow from it, they're still entangled. And those entanglements are detrimental and they will corrupt. They will continue to damage the very soul who's trapped within it, and the larger damage will continue, the ripple effects. And so I'm certainly not saying that volunteering for causes or becoming or standing for others' rights and or becoming involved in the world is at all a bad thing. And I'm certainly not saying that people shouldn't do that or philanthropy, giving money, to remedy situations. But do you see that, and this is a part that's really hard for me to articulate, but Jesus shows me this again and again, that do you see that internally within yourself, until that changes, nothing changes. I'm really going to sit with this as much as I can to find a better way to bring this alive, what I'm kind of shown at times in the various dreams and what happens is that the trap doors are all still there. Okay, so there's the trap of addiction, say, the money machine of the money of medicine, the pharmaceutical conglomerates and, or national security, say, or, you know, that's all still there. The hunger that exists for food, the hunger that exists for truth, war, the creation of class society, the continuation of this world where we fear that one's religion or heritage or homeland somehow makes them suspect. Sex trafficking, cover-ups that require the silencing of individuals and entire groups in society who are stripped of meaning by one system or another, over and over and over and over again. It's self-perpetuating. That's the state of our world. These are the choices of humanity. These are the choices in which we have either made directly and or been witness to, and often been witness to when we were still involved. It's insidious. It's treachery. It is enslavement, and it happens over generations. And the news, aside, I was a journalism major. I believe in the authenticity of journalism, and I believe that there is a place and value to it. Communication is important. But the news, which is controlled by entertainment and by individuals who are in power and who are themselves embedded within and caught up in these webs of deceit, the news, which is directed by those in power, simply churns out stories of bad acts, and that news is old news. So, and we're still are the channels that provide a pipeline for the perpetuation of propaganda, which it's only propaganda, and it's wrapped up in this package of helpful guidance, as if those supposedly served by a particular system or an organization or a structure or whatever it be, are in need of the wisdom that is gathered and gleaned and then, you know, offered up on a silver platter from a particular perspective. Completely one perspective. Do you see? One slice of the pie. Not even a pie. No. One slice of a sphere. And I don't even think that. I think there's even more there. But you get what I'm saying, right? It's one perspective. And it's like, do this, do this. It's like propaganda is probably a bit stronger than, not much. Not much. And those who are within that, whatever that system is, and offering that perspective, truly, most of them truly believe that this will help. But do you see that right there? This will help. And somehow they are in service to a system of belief that while many of these systems of belief have great value and are connected to a true stream in some way, the whole way that this machine is churning is it simply feeds corruption. Okay, the good news is this, okay? The good news is that disillusionment is the first step to free your soul from all that binds. So we need to see the illusion, and we need to step into the clearing of our own life and lead from love. I think Mother Mary really wants us to read this, so I'm going to read it in just a second. I keep dropping it. So let me think about what I was saying there. Okay, so see the illusion and step into the clearing of your own life and lead from love, however you can do it in small ways and lead your own life. I'm not saying go lead the masses, okay? Lead your own life from love and let that be the testimony. Let that be your offering of grace. That's the first step when everything falls apart. This is how we begin again from what appears to be the end of the road, the end of the world as we know it. The solution is not to see ourselves as separate from this world that's, kind of fallen. And neither is it to resign ourselves to simply surrender to it, right? It's not like giving in or giving up, and it's not seeing that as other than us. The solution's not to keep quiet and just live in isolation. as much as I kind of like to do that sometimes, nor is it, it's not to demand that those that we love wake up and see their enslavement to the world. That's not a solution. Mm-hmm. We have to respect everyone's right to choose for themselves. The solution is simply in the dissolution, in beginning with a full acknowledgement of that dissolution. I looked up the word acknowledge. So we have to understand, you know, like that individually and collectively, there's some culpability there and that we have been a part of this collusion. So to acknowledge means to accept the existence of and to recognize the importance of or quality of a thing. To accept the existence of or to recognize the importance or quality of a thing, to acknowledge. And only when we acknowledge the truth can we hope to create a whole new way forward together. So we have to take full responsibility for every choice we make right now and heal the chasms of division that have grown deeper and deeper over time and into which so many have fallen, right? It's that fault line and it's that individual, that first decision we made usually individually way back, but we all had to make them to be in agreement with these systems. See, we all had to make them, but we think we had no choice because we were trained, we were indoctrinated into this, you know, this way of this approach to life that is quite narrow, and it is built on the idea of division itself and fear of the other. And we gotta just start with what is, and most of all, bear witness to the miracle of God. So dare to pull back the veil in your own life and know that you can trust life. And, you know, life is not what we've been taught. Life is much more than that. So look to nature and the natural world to learn again what life is and see that you are, as you are, a dynamic and sustainable system. You're a system. And you can draw on that energy of your soul because it is pure and it is whole and it is of inestimable value in right now in this time. So tend to what's been entrusted to you and begin within. I'm going to read now Isaiah 29, which was what the angels were telling me that I needed to share along with this message today. So, just sharing with you all that I really definitely feel this, and some others are talking about it with regard to what it will be. I have no idea what it will be or when it will happen. I do feel like it's pretty imminent. Like I would say, the next 6 months. It's April of 2017 when I'm recording this. It looks like the beginning of the end, but again, it's a beginning. Again, it's an opportunity. Okay, so Isaiah 29 is what they asked me to share with you. So here it is from the New International Version. Woe to you, Ariel, Ariel, the city where David settled. Add year to year and let your cycle of festivals go on. Yet I will besiege Ariel. She will mourn and lament. She will be to me like an altar hearth. I will encamp against you on all sides. I will encircle you with towers and set up my siege works against you. Brought low, you will speak from the ground. Your speech will mumble out of the dust. Your voice will come ghost-like from the earth. Out of the dust, your speech will whisper. But your many enemies will become like fine dust, the ruthless hordes like blown chaff. Suddenly, in an instant, the Lord Almighty will come with thunder and earthquake and great noise, with windstorm and tempest and flames of a devouring fire. Then the hordes of all nations that fight against Ariel, that attack her and her fortress and besiege her, will be as it is with a dream, with a vision in the night. As when a hungry person dreams of eating but awakens hungry still. As when a thirsty person dreams of drinking but awakens faint and thirsty still. So it will be with hordes of all the nations that fight against Mount Zion. Be stunned and amazed. Blind yourselves and be sightless. Be drunk, but not from wine. Stagger, but not from beer. The Lord has brought over you a deep sleep. He has sealed your eyes, the prophets. He has covered your heads, the seers. For you, this whole vision is nothing but words sealed in a scroll. And if you give the scroll to someone who can read and say, read this, please, they will answer, I can't, it is sealed. Or if you give the scroll to someone who cannot read and say, read this, please, they will answer, I don't know how to read. The Lord says, these people come near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship of me is based on merely human rules they have been taught. Therefore, once more, I will astound these people with wonder upon wonder. The wisdom of the wise will perish. The intelligence of the intelligent will vanish. Woe to those who go to great depths to hide their plans from the Lord, who do their work in darkness and think, who sees us? Who will know? You turn things upside down as if the potter were thought to be like the clay. Shall what is formed say to the one who formed it, you did not make me? Can the pot say to the potter, you know nothing? In a very short time, will not Lebanon be turned into a fertile field, and the fertile field seem like a forest? In that day, the deaf will hear the words from the scroll, and out of gloom and darkness, the eyes of the blind will see. Once more, the humble will rejoice in the Lord. The needy will rejoice in the Holy One of Israel. The ruthless will vanish. The mockers will disappear. And all who have an eye for evil will be cut down. Those who, with a word, make someone out to be guilty, who ensnare the defender in court, and with false testimony deprive the innocent of justice. Therefore, this is what the Lord who redeemed Abraham says to the descendants of Jacob. No longer will Jacob be ashamed. No longer will their faces grow pale. When they see among them their children, the works of my hands, they will keep my name holy. They will acknowledge the holiness of the Holy One of Jacob and will stand in awe of the God of Israel. Those who are wayward in spirit will gain understanding. Those who complain will accept instruction. So, I hope that there was something there. I invite you to read that again. That was Isaiah chapter 29. And God is doing a great work right now. And there is much revelation happening in our world. I'm going to link to three poems that I wrote that do relate to some of the dreams that I was reminded of recently. One is called The World is Opening Up. One is called After the Shock. And the third poem is called Third World War Within the Hearts of Man. So I will link to those for you. And let's close with reading the card I drew from this deck called Mary, Queen of Angels. And I haven't looked yet to see, but the card... Okay, the card is Truth. I am lovingly honest with myself and others. That feels perfect, doesn't it? Oh, I'm so sorry. So, I am lovingly honest with myself and others. Truth. And let me read from the book as we close today. Thank you for staying with me if you have. I know this video was also long. It just felt very important that I, you know, speak to it for myself. And I hope there was something of value there that you can take with you. Truth. I am lovingly honest with myself and others. You drew this card. Oh, how perfect is this? Okay. You drew this card because some truth is being hidden. Most likely, you are the one hiding it from yourself. How do you really feel about your present situation? This card counsels you to take an honest inventory, admitting your most vulnerable feelings to yourself. If someone isn't being forthright with you, you'll know this within your heart. The first person who comes to mind is probably involved in this dishonesty. Sometimes people aren't truthful because their fears of conflict make them people please. Other times dishonesty stems from a lack mentality arising when individuals believe that they have to take on what they want because there's not enough to go around. Take the time to sit quietly in meditation and ask God and Holy Spirit to reveal the truth about your present situation. Although truth has a subjective component and opinions about the same situation will vary from person to person, there is a need for greater honesty in order to heal and resolve the present situation. I think that what I've realized for myself and what may be true for some of you is that there are people in our worlds, for some of us, that those are people that we love dearly, family and friends. For some of us, it may even be our intended divine partner. For some of us, it may be systems of belief and or circles of belonging that matter to us. For myself, you know, the church is certainly one of those, even though I've been not a part of it for a long time. And there also may be, so this hits close to home, doesn't it? This hits close to home because all of us, like I was trying to say earlier in this video, all of us are connected in some way to these, you know, webs of deceit that have existed. So another thing Jesus was talking to me about that I'm not sure I mentioned, I want to say quickly, is that it's very going to be very tempting to those of us who have been enlightened and awakened and perhaps seen some of this coming. It's going to be very tempting to see this as, you know, we are not in any way involved in this, or just, again, to see it as other people who are exposed in some way, and we ourselves, you know, maybe is also, you know, exposed, because I think that's what God is doing. That is the awe that we are invited to see, and it may be tempting for us to remove ourselves from it and, you know, be disgusted with the whole thing and say, this is not who I am. But it's what we're called to do is to stand in that circle, like I said in the beginning of this video, to stand and be strong. And the way that we are strong is to return to those three things, I think, that Jesus has invited us to do. And I will post those below. Much love to you. And this one, you know, this is one of those videos that, like, I'm like, do I really have to do this? Because I don't want to. It just feels so distasteful. And so this is me seeing that I'm really one of those who would rather, in some ways, you know, I do think it's important to acknowledge it, but I'd rather, you know, just have a little bit of distance there. But the fact is that we are called, right now in our world to be the light of Christ and to be a part of redeeming that which is pure and holy, and helping people to see that that has not died within them, that it is alive. And the way we do that is to begin by seeing it alive within ourselves and keeping and tending to that flame of truth. So I'm also hearing the song Honesty by Billy Joel, and a fragment of another song I can't quite place right now, but also around the ideas of returning to truth, beginning with truth to ourselves, speaking the truth to ourselves and acknowledging that truth, and being true when we show up in relationship with one another. Much love to you guys, and I appreciate, again, your listening to this video and all you are doing to shine your light in the world. I'm really being called to do more of these videos, and so if they're helpful, let me know. If there's something you'd like for me to speak to, send me an email, dawnrichardson@gmail.com, and certainly if you're looking for sustained support so that you can return to that dynamic and sustainable system that you are, you can check out my 90 Days to Life, which is on my website. So I am being called to speak more of these videos, and so your gifts and your donations are appreciated in any amount, because they help me to sustain my life while I'm here, and just, you know, be able to do that without without needing to compromise the time that I'm able to devote to that. So thank you very much. Love you, and see you soon. Bye.